Well, we're going through 1 Peter, and we're kind of taking our time in this sort of stretch that we're in, because there's just too much, I don't know, there's some doctrine in there, and there's some really good application in there, and I don't know that it'd be good just to kind of gloss over those things. It's good to kind of focus in on them, and then what we've been trying to do is sort of add them into a bigger picture, a bigger context, to sort of see things as they're coming at us. So let's, to accomplish that, let's do a little bit of review. The context of pretty much the whole letter has to do with trials, Christians going through trials, whether that be persecution because they are Christians, or, you know, you could extrapolate that out to just any kind of trials, any kind of pressure that comes at you. These are the things that Peter says, this is what you need to do when you get into these trials, when you get into these situations, in order to, you know, not get, you know, dragged down into the depths of despair, the pit of despair, where the flesh wants to take you, because there's so much more that God has for us when we get into these situations. There's life, and there's joy, and there's more to life than when you get into these patterns of when life just is in the gutter and it's not fun at all. And one of the first things that Peter reminds us to do is in verse 13. He says, therefore, gird up the loins of your mind. And our sort of modern day illustration of that is roll up the sleeves of your mind, right? Get your mind ready to go. Put on the seatbelt of your mind. Get it ready for action. And then he says, be sober, which means be clear-headed, which when trials come, it's easy for our heads, our minds to go 1,000 different directions and all this other stuff gets poured in there. And he says, no, be sober, be clear-headed. Get your mind ready to go, be clear-headed, and rest your hope fully on the grace that is going to be revealed in Jesus Christ, right? Not just kind of put your hope leaning on it, not just sort of against it or around it or by it, but rest your hope completely. Put it on there, put all of your hopes on God's grace. Let it all just sit there and rest. And also part of the context, the immediate context of this passage has to do with the gospel and just the amazingness of the gospel, right? Because running into verse 12, Peter kind of goes on this little side trip of how the prophets looked into this and they didn't understand it, and they came to realize that it wasn't for them, it was for us who are today. And angels look into the gospel and don't get it, they don't understand it. And he's saying, this is for us, this is for you guys, this is for today. So he's going to get into a little bit of what this gospel part means. So just kind of with that picture in our heads, let's sort of get a reading running start, starting at verse 13 again. Therefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and rest your hope fully on the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not conforming yourselves to the former lusts, as in your ignorance, that's not going back to your old ways, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy. And that was a command. Remember, the be is a command. Be holy in all your conduct, even when you're going through trials and stress. Because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. And this is where we're at today. And if you call on the Father, who without partiality judges according to each one's work, conduct yourselves throughout the time of your stay in fear, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. He indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was made manifest in these last times for you, who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Some great, awesome stuff. Let's see if we can sort of get into it and live it out a little bit. The first sort of big picture point I want us to see is this, and it's kind of a running picture of where we're coming from. We talked about fear last week a little bit. We're going to talk a little bit about it today. Last week we said that fear drives us from the truth, right? Fear drives us from truth of God's word, and it drives us from the truth, Jesus Christ. And then kind of extending that into today, not only do we put our hope in the wrong things, but we do the same things with our fear. We put our fear in the wrong things. We could switch that around. We also do the same things with our hope. We can put our hope in the wrong things. We can put our hope in ourselves. We can put our hope in another person. We can put our hope in a job, in money, in whatever. We put our hope in something when Peter tells us to put our hope completely on God. So he's making this contrast between what we used to do and what we can do now. And what we can do now can take different directions, right? We can go back to our old ways, what we used to do, or we can do what God has enabled us to do through Jesus, which is this, to call, right? Verse 17, and if you call on the Father, and I like to look up words and just see what's kind of behind the nitty-gritty of a lot of these words. And to call specifically means, you know, it's like when a teacher calls on a student. They call on a person by name. It's not just a hey you kind of call. It's not hey buddy, hey pal. You know, it's Steve. It's, you know, Susie. It's a call. It's somebody's name. I'm calling on you specifically. So when he says, if you call on the Father, so when we say, God, Father, help, you know, when we call on him, when we invoke his name, when you call on the Father, like a teacher calling on a student. And this context is help. You know, when you're in that position where trials and tempting and you're suffering, it's just not fun, right? And you say, God, we do that, right? It seems like we often call on God more when we're in trouble than when things are going okay, which is kind of a bummer, because think about that from a parental perspective. What if your kids only ever came to you when they were in trouble or needed something? How would you feel? You wouldn't, you know, if you never saw them other than when they needed, you know, Dad, I need $5. Or I guess now it's 50, because, you know, you can't just... I'd go to my, you know, parents or my grandmother to want to play video games at the arcade, and I'd say, can I have a quarter? That got you one game. Now it's like you need 3 quarters to play a game, but I digress. Sorry. Don't want to share those issues here today. But if we just go to God when we need him, when we just, God, you know, does that make him feel like a heavenly ATM? When you need something, you just go and put in your Jesus card and you get grace out, or what? How does that work? I mean, we should develop the habit of calling on him when things are good, right? Just give God thanks for stuff. Just when something happens, get into the habit of saying, God, this is from you. Anything that's good that comes to our lives is from God. And it's just appropriate to thank him for that, to worship him for that, just by saying, thank you, God. But if we call on him, like Peter says, when the trials are coming, if you call on the Father, who without partiality judges according to each one's work. And when it says judges, it means to discern between two things, to say if this is a good thing, this is a bad thing, to declare something, you know, appropriate or inappropriate. It could even mean to decide. God decides this is good, God decides this is bad. And it says that he does that without partiality, right? God doesn't play favorites. Everyone's the same. Everyone's on the same footing. Whoever, doesn't matter. You, somebody you think is super saint, somebody you think is super sinner, all on the same footing, without partiality. When you call on God, he sees you the same as he sees anybody else who's in him, which is cool, which is amazingly cool. There's no brownie points. There's no sliding scale for God. It's just he sees us and he says, you're on the same, who's goody two? Mother Teresa's dead, so we can't really compare, because she's usually the one people would go to compare for things like that. But it's just the same, and I don't know how much more simply to say it than that, but God sees us all the same. So knowing that, going to God, that he sees us that way, if you call on him, knowing that he sees us all the same, Peter says, conduct yourselves throughout the time of your stay here in fear. And what's maybe not obvious from the language is he's talking about it from the perspective of, you know, sort of traveling pilgrims, people who are not from here, who are just sort of passing through, like Bedouins, or when Abraham was in the land, he didn't have his own property. He lived in tents. They would pack up and they would move, and they would pack up and they would move, and they would pack up and they would move, and that's sort of how they lived. That's how they survived. So when it says to conduct yourselves throughout the time of your stay here in fear, it's temporary. It's like we're camping, right? When you go camp, well, I don't know. Now that I think through this a bit more, if I were to go camping, when I was growing up camping, it was just with the Boy Scouts. It was tent and sleeping bag and enough food to get you by, and that was pretty much it. It was miserable. Boy Scout camping in the Northwest is just one of the worst experiences ever. It's just rainy and cold, and Boy Scouts can't start a fire, so you have lukewarm hot dogs, and it's bad news. But when you go camping, not with an RV, not with your tent with the generator outside and the microwave and the TV and the satellite, that's not camping, that's a portable hotel room. But when you go real camping, adventure, rugged man camping, you have a light touch wherever you go. You don't want to leave trash. You're not really invested in that place. It's just a short term. You want to keep it clean. You want to keep it nice. But you're leaving that place, aren't you? You're not moving in. You're not going to leave all your stuff around. You're not going to invest in making everything perfect because it's just a short term venture. At least it's supposed to be, right? So in a way, our time here is like we're camping, which means it's really kind of pointless to invest ourselves in such a way that it's like it's permanent. To our resources, our time, our hearts, our passions, to invest in something that's temporary, he says, don't do that. It's spend your time here in fear. Now, that's also not to say this. It's, you know, people could read that and go, does that mean I'm supposed to be afraid all the time? It's like, God's going to get me all the time. I'm afraid. You could never have joy that way, could you? You could never experience grace that way because you're in a constant state of fear. That's not so much what he's saying. Because fear isn't always a bad thing. We talked about, you know, fear drives us from the truth. That's fear of things in the world, right? Fear of things in the world drives us from truth, but fear of God drives us to truth. Because fear can be useful. Fear can be beneficial. If you should be afraid of what a gun can do, right? It's supposed to be. That's kind of the whole point of a gun is fear. You can be afraid of what a gun can do, but there's a right way to use it. It inspires respect. It should, anyway. When you have something that can do that's that powerful, it should inspire a sense of fear and respect, but it can also be used. And that's kind of the way it is with God. God's not standing up there with his lightning bolt ready to strike, ready to nail us, but we should have a sense of fear and awe and respect for God. Or, you know, think about it this way. Because, again, the context is trials. So, he says, don't fall back into your old patterns. So fear comes, and you fall back into your old patterns of not trusting in God, but trusting in your own self and in your own thing and whatever you're doing. And you've been neglecting God in that way, right? And then you finally figure out, you know, God, I'm supposed to go to God. And that's a good thing to figure out. But if you just... Again, if you go to him to like that heavenly ATM and you have no sense of fear or respect for him, it doesn't always work out. I mean, we just went through the whole book of Judges. And you remember our Judges shuffle? The people began in sin, and God judges that sin with servitude. They were subject to the nations around them. After a while of that servitude, the people finally figured it out and called on God, and they made supplication, right? And then when they cried out to God in supplication, God brought them salvation. But after a generation or two goes by, what happens? They would spiral back into that sin, right? They would lose the fear. They would lose the sense of this is our God. He is holy. We must go to him at all times because he loves us and we love him. They would lose that. And Peter's saying kind of the same thing. Is that when you're here and you say you're living for God, do it. Live like it. There should be a sense of fear because this is just temporary. There is going to come a time and a place when we be held accountable to him. And then when that time and place comes, if you're in him, it's not so much whether you're going to be saved or not saved, because if you're in Christ, you are saved. It's a done deal. It's complete. But when we do appear before him, he is going to reward us. And some people will get more rewards than others. Now, that's not to say that our lives here should just be totally reward-driven. That's not the point. The point is that he is going to look at us. He is going to look at our works. He's going to look at our lives and say, you know what, you did good with what you had. You did great with what you had, and you get some, and you get more, and there is going to be that time. That day will come. But there is supposed to be this sense of fear. Well, what about perfect love casts out fear? And remember, it's the difference between fear of the world and fear of God. Perfect love from God does cast out fear. It casts out fear of the world. It's supposed to, in a way. Another place, it says God has not given us a spirit of fear. And he hasn't, but of love and of power and a sound mind. That spirit of love drives out fear of the world. But that doesn't mean there's no fear whatsoever, because we're commanded to fear God, right? Okay, so we're on the same page. So conduct the time of your stay here with fear. Temporary. It's a light, it's tread lightly. It's like you're camping. You're here to be used by God to bring people into the kingdom, but you don't invest your sense of self-worth and everything that's in you here. It's temporary. It's there. It's, what is it? Paul says that our citizenship is in heaven. It's not here. We're resident aliens here. We live here a short time, and then we go home. We go to where our real home is, our real country. So why with fear? He says, do it with fear. Why? Well, that kind of gets answered further in the next verse, 18. Knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things, like silver or gold, from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers. So it has to do with what we value, doesn't it? I mean, our next sort of big picture point is this. We don't put any value in things that don't have value, right? I mean, it sounds stupid, sounds simple, but that's the reality. We don't put value in something that we don't value, that has any value in and of itself. It might be valuable to somebody else, but it's not valuable to us. We just don't do that. And the flip-flop is true, too. We do put value in things that are valuable to us. The problem is we don't recognize what has value and what doesn't. Right? We don't always recognize what is the valuable thing and what is not. Our priorities can be flip-flopped, especially when we're going through trials. We can put value in, what did we talk about last week? Some people go to food. Some people go to drugs. Some people go to pornography. Some people go to within themselves. They completely shut off. Whatever that thing is we go to, we put value in that. And it's when you look at your life, or you can look at other people's lives, you can see what's valuable to them. You can see what they put significance in, what they put importance in, right? The problem is for us is that we don't always recognize what really has value. And Peter is going to give us a quick lesson in what really is valuable. So this, verse 18 again, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things. There's that fun word, redeemed. What does it mean to be redeemed? Well, just the word itself means to be freed. The root has to do with being freed. It has to do with being loosed. It has to do with being freed and loosed because a price was paid for the thing, right? It's not just simply that you've been freed or you've been loosed. It's a price has been paid. You've been redeemed because somebody paid a price to let loose, to let free. Well, why do we need that? Simple question, right? Basic question. Why do we need to be loose? Because we're tied up. We're born in a state of being tied up. We're born in a state of being trapped. Every human being is born in that state. And because of that, we need to be loosed. We're born, we've said this before, we don't sin and become a sinner. We sin because we are sinners, right? A car thief doesn't become a car thief because they stole a car. They stole a car because they're a car thief. It's the same idea. We're born that way, and we need to be freed from that. In addition to that, Peter points out specifically because of the aimless conduct from the traditions of your fathers. Now, you know, you can talk about this. Is he writing to a Greek audience? Is he writing to a Jewish audience? He's writing to a kind of a hybrid audience. You know, the way they would, in many cases, in many cultures back then, if to redeem yourself, to appease the God who you think is angry at you, you would go and make an offering at the temple, typically money. You'd go pay yourself out, right? Well, here's my money, so, and the priest is like, okay, now the God is happy with you, and you can go on your way. It's like, well, that, okay. that's an interesting way to do that process. You know, have you ever tried to buy your way out of trouble? Busted by parents, or busted by a teacher, or busted by a boss, or whoever it is, or God, you get in a situation where you feel like God's getting on you, and what do? God, if you just let me go, right? God, if you just take this pressure off, I will, and you fill in your own blank. I will go to church more, I promise. I'll give more. I'll give up this habit. I'll quit doing this. I'll start doing that. We try to buy ourselves out of trouble. We can do that with parents. We can do that with whoever. It's all, if you take the pressure off of me, I'll take care of it. I'll give you this. I'll do this for you. It doesn't work. Well, it might work sometimes in this world, but with God, it doesn't work. You can't buy yourself out of trouble with God because you and I don't have anything of value to buy us out of that trouble. You and I don't have anything that can be paid to loose us or free us from being in bondage, from being trapped. God doesn't want our promises. He doesn't want our vows. He doesn't want our deals. The only thing that we can give him is our heart and our mind and our soul and our strength. Isn't that the greatest commandment, right? You love the Lord with your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. That's the only thing we can give him. But giving him that doesn't free us. It doesn't loose us. But it is what he wants from us. It's, you can go back to and read David's in Psalm 51 when he's crying out to God and pleading for forgiveness. He says, you know what, God, I know that you don't want burnt offerings. That you it's part of the ritual, God, I know that, but that's not really what you're after. You're not after barbecue to take care of my sin. Barbecue's pretty good. But that's not really what you want. What you want is a broken spirit. You want a broken and a contrite heart. You just want me to come to you and say, lay it out and say, God, I'm sorry. God, I need you. That's the only thing we can give him. But again, that doesn't pay the price. That doesn't loose us. That doesn't redeem us. We can't buy ourselves out of that. So what does? Verse 18 again, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold, but from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb, without blemish and without spot. It's the blood. That is the only thing that can pay the price. The only thing that is of enough value to God to pay for us. Now, can you give Jesus' blood? Can I give Jesus' blood? Do we have that to give to God? No. So nobody else, you can't buy yourself. You can't give what you don't have. Right? It sounds silly, stupid and silly, but you can't give what you don't have. So God does it. God did it for us. It's huge, and it sounds, why does God want blood? And it has to do with, I don't know how much I want to go into that, but why does God want blood? Because the wages of sin is death. That's probably the most simple answer to give on that, right? When sin occurs, a death is what is required to take care of that sin. And the only death that can really take care of that sin is Jesus' death, is the Son of God. It's not our death. Our death doesn't free us from sin. It doesn't pay the price to loose us. Only Jesus' blood can do that. And it's as if it's the blood, it's like a lamb without spot or blemish. When the sacrificial system was happening, that was the lamb. It had no spots, no messed up wool, no blemishes, no nothing. It had to be a perfectly clean, white, spotless lamb. And Jesus played that part for us. Voluntarily. Willingly. He willingly laid down his life. Now think about this too. And I've probably said this before, but it still just blows my mind, that the price to pay for us as individuals, right, for you and for me, the price to pay to loose us, to free us, to redeem us, was Jesus' blood. And from God's perspective, that's worth it. His Son, from his perspective, was worth paying the price so that you and I could be redeemed, could be washed free of sin. Is anybody else's brain cells exploding right now? Doesn't that just freak you out that from God's perspective, I'm worth that. You're worth that. Now I'm afraid. Now I'm experiencing the fear that Peter is talking about, because that just freaks me out that God would do that, that the God of the universe would do that. And it's humbling and it's awesome, and that's what it's supposed to invoke in us. It's supposed to evoke humility, and it's supposed to invoke a sense of, wow, okay, God, if you did that for me, I'm yours. Here's all my heart. Here's all my mind. Here's all my strength. Take it and do what you want with it, please. That's what we were redeemed with. And then Peter goes on a little bit more about Jesus in verse 20. He indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you. And I like how he says to you. He's trying to make it personal to these people. He doesn't say for us, although it is for us, he included. But he says for you, that he was foreordained for you, but was made manifest in these last times for you. And again, that was the only thing. And this is kind of my last big picture point for this passage is that the only thing, and again, this is what he's talking about, that our hope and our faith can be in is God, not ourselves, not our resources, just Jesus. So what's this idea of foreordained? We talked about foreordained and foreknowledge when we first got into the book, because back early on in the first couple of verses, in verse 2, it says, talking about us, that we're elect according to the foreknowledge of God. Now, that's about us, but here it's saying about Jesus. Now, everything in the Bible, my mind must not be that complicated because everything makes it want to blow. It's cool. That Jesus was foreordained. Think about that. Before the foundation of the world. That before, and not just the foundation like a slab of concrete that a house is built upon, but you could say, churches have a founding day when they began. So before the foundation of the church means the time before that church started, not the physical slab that they might be built on. Same idea, before the foundation of the world, before the world was founded. So before Adam and Eve sinned, right? Before Adam and Eve took their first breath, before God said, let there be light, in those early verses of Genesis, before in the beginning was the heavens and the earth, right? Before all of that, Jesus was foreordained. Before all of that, he was crucified. Before any of this ever happened, it was done. So, again, it's not like God made the heavens and the earth, and then he made Adam and Eve, and then Adam and Eve eat the fruit, and God goes, uh-oh, what am I going to do now? They ate this fruit. They've messed up my whole plan. What am I going to do? Oh, bing! And he has an idea, and says, I'm going to send Jesus. That's not what he does. That's not how it worked. It was all done before. Now, this gets into all kinds of fun, is it free will? Is it predestination? How does this work? Think about this. Even if all of this, our whole lives, everything we think, do, say, and speak, and go and interact with, even if every detail of existence is scripted from God's perspective, does it change anything? Does it matter from our perspective? No. Why? Because we can't do anything about it. We can't change it. The only thing that you and I can do in this life is make choices based on the information that's in front of us, right? That's all that we can do is when we come to intersection and we have to choose left or right, that's all that we can do. We can't see beyond that. We can hardly see behind us. But even if that is true, and people will say, well, if that's true, then God's not fair because we really don't have choice. That doesn't change anything. Doesn't affect anything at all from our perspective, because all we can do is what's right in front of us. And if we get to the point where we recognize I'm a sinner in need of a Savior, Jesus is there. And he's been there before Genesis 1:1. God knew. God planned. However you want to look at that, it was done. Jesus was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you. Hooray! Yay! We're there! Now, it was for them. These people he's writing to didn't see Jesus. They didn't physically see him. Maybe some of them did, but most of them probably not. So I think we can be included in this you, because it's from that point on, we're in these last days, and Jesus was manifested for us. Yes! Awesome, that's just so cool. Who, through him, verse 21, who through him believe in God. He's talking about it. Well, the verse breaks don't always work for me, so let's connect those two together. But was manifest in these last times for you, who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. So through who do we believe in God? Sunday school answer? That's right. Through Jesus. He's the only one through whom we can believe in God. It's only through Jesus that we can believe in God, or rather, that God receives our belief in him. Because people will say, well, there's all kinds of different ways, and people believe in God, and it's all different, and doesn't God accept it all? No. Sorry. I hope no bubbles are burst. But it is only through him. Jesus himself says it in John 14:6. I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. Now, people have argued that context lately and said, well, he's not really talking about salvation. He's talking about the way of life, the way of living, that Jesus' way is the way that God wanted us to live. And that's true. We're supposed to follow his example. But that's not what Jesus was talking about. I mean, if you want to look at it in context, you can go there, John 14. Jesus is sort of not really playing word games with them, but he's trying to explain something to them, and they're just not picking up on it. It's always good to read it in context. Go to verse 1 of John 14. This is Jesus speaking. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. Significant. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. So he's telling them he's going somewhere. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. So he's talking about going somewhere and coming back, right? Pretty obvious, pretty clear. Okay, good. And where I go, you know, and the way you know. Verse 5, Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going, and how can we know the way? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would also have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him. So he's going to the Father, and he's coming back to the Father. So when Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me, is he talking simply about a way of life? No. He's talking about how do you get to the Father? How do you get to God? Or in other words, how do you get saved? It's only through him, who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead. God raised him from the dead, and God gave him glory so that your faith and hope are in God. So the resurrection not only gives us salvation, the resurrection provides us with a place to put our faith and our hope. And like he said at the beginning, rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. And it's through his blood that we have this. It's through his blood that we have been redeemed. Now, I want to close with a story that I heard a while ago. And when I first heard it, I thought, that is so cheesy. That's so stupid. I would never tell that story. I'm going to tell that story. And hopefully I can do it some justice. Long time ago, before internet, before TV, before video games, my kid's about passed out just now, there wasn't a whole lot to do, necessarily, where this little boy grew up. So what a lot of kids his age would do would be to pick up hobbies, or to do some hobbies were good, some hobbies were bad, like throwing rocks at windows, not a good hobby. This little boy in particular decided to pick up wood carving. Just with a little pocket knife, he would get sticks and chunks of wood, and he would carve stuff out. And he got pretty good at it. And he got this one particular piece of wood, and close to his house there was a pond, small lake, big pond, body of water. And he decided to carve a boat. So he carved out this boat, spent time, spent effort, spent care, carving it out just right, so it's just the right shape, and a little mast on it to stick, and they carved out the hole for the mast. And he got a piece of fabric from his mom, from her sewing kit, and made a little sail on it, and he was excited. I built it! I made this thing! This is so cool! I love this thing! I'm going to take it to the pond and see if it'll go. So he takes it to the pond, and he puts it out there in the water, and he happens to be wearing some nice clothes, and he didn't want to get wet or dirty, but he was just too excited about this to not wait to go change and put on his grubby clothes. So he puts it out there in the water, and it floats, and he's like, yes! It does what it's supposed to do. And just then, this really gentle breeze came up from behind him and started to push the boat out onto the pond. And he sort of stood there, come back, little bug. This thing that he made and he cared for was being blown away from him. And it was too far out. He was all dirty, and he didn't want to get out there and get messy, so he watched it for as long as he could, and he saw he couldn't get it. It was getting dark, and he knew his mom was going to miss him if he was gone too long, so he had to leave his boat. He was very sad, and he went home, all like, droopy, look, my boat, I'm sad. And his mom tried to comfort him, and he was upset because he cared about this thing, right? He just put so much investment and effort into this, and he lost it. Or rather, it was taken away from him, however you want to look at that. Well, a few days go by, and he's still pretty bummed about this boat, and he's walking with his mother on the main street in town, and there's shops like we have here, little restaurant shops and cafes and antique shops, and there was sort of this curio shop, just where odd stuff was collected. And they're walking by, and in the big glass window, he happens to look up, and he sees in the window on the shelf his boat. He's like, yes, that's my boat. I made that. That's cool. Let's go get the boat. So they go inside, and the mom and he tries to explain to the man in the store, the boat, I made that. That was my boat. That's mine. And the man said, I don't know that it's yours. I can't just give it to you, because if everybody who came in said, hey, that's my thing in the window, and I gave it away, I wouldn't have a store. So the boy was like, but it's mine. I made it. My boat. And the mom tried to say, honey, we can't just give it away. And the boy asked his mom, well, can I use some of my allowance to get the boat? And she goes, I guess so. Sure. And how much is the boat? And the man was like $5. And so he negotiated with mom to give him the allowance money. And he went to the window, grabbed the boat, and he went outside and he looked at the boat and he said, you're mine. I made you and I bought you. You're mine. That's what it is with God. That's what it is with Jesus. He made us, and he bought us, and we're his. And it's just awesome that he would do that, that he would care enough about his creation to do that, to buy us not with something like silver or gold that is, just more rocks to God, but with the blood of his son, that we're worth that to him. It's just cool, and it's awesome. So put your hope in that. Don't put your hope in the world or your 401k or anything else. Put your hope in that, because we're temporarily here. This is a part-time gig. We're going to be moving on who knows when. So that's what I want us to walk away with today, is to put our hope in that we're his, that we can be his. And if you're not, you can be. You just have to say, God, I'm yours. Yeah? Amen? All right.